Deirdre, for the open house to come into your whānau and minister once again, second time here, I think. Yeah. So it's good to be here. So thank you for that honour. So I honour you fellas. And thank you, whānau. Good to see some of you. I know you already. And just be good among you. It's great to have my wife, Jess, with me. She doesn't get to come with me all the time around the motu. So it's really good to have Jess here. And it's just really, really great to be here. Looking forward to being here. And most of all, sort of just so honored and love the presence of Jesus. Beautiful presence of God. So I'm just going to get straight into it, you know what I'm saying? I've just got back from India, it feels like. And India is part of our whānau family. We have at least 17 churches over there. And I wish what is happening in India would be happening here in Gisborne, happening in our nation here. And the church over there grew from 130 to 3,000 in 7 years. And this is Muslims, Hindus, communists coming to Christ in their droves, literally. And they're coming because the Christians there have been trained to get into the office called the Office of the Believer. And because they operate in the Office of the Believer, they're seeing signs and wonders and miracles follow them normally. It's part of their lifestyle. And not only that, we're doing social impact programs. We have a school where we educate the poorest of the poor, and we sponsor them from our own church. And so we provide food, 2 meals a day, 2 uniforms, private schooling, and homework tutors for $8 a week, one child. And we've been going for 14 years, and now our children who started as little children from the slums, parents couldn't afford to feed them, let alone educate them. And so we went in there and we stood in the gap, like Jesus said, I was hungry and you fed me. So we're sponsoring there. And now these first generation kids, many of them graduated, some of them bachelor degrees in computer science and engineering and nursing, and incredible. Some with masters. These are slum kids who were illiterate, parents were illiterate. So we have this incredible church over in India that is transforming their community. It's Kingdom Church. It's the problem with churches, they just embrace Christians. But the kingdom embraces all people. And Jesus didn't come to embrace just Christians. He came to embrace the world. And so Kingdom Churches embrace all people. You know, everybody. Everybody. And so that's what we're seeing over there. And that's what we're looking forward to seeing happen here in this old Aotearoa. When the Lord is allowed to have his way, and we allow him and help him build his hahi, his church. So miracles are normal. You know, people say, tell us some more miracles. Well, for me, it's less lifestyle. Miracles are not an event for me. Miracles are lifestyle. They happen every week for me, and for Jess and most of our people who have been trained. And I want to talk about that today. Have you ever been to a shop where you want to, it's lunchtime, and you've got to shoot down to the shop at lunchtime, and while you've got time off work, just go down to the shop and you've got to, I don't know, you want to buy something or you got to get a part for your car or something for the house. And you get down there and you've only got 20 minutes and there's a sign on the door, out of the office. Have you ever had that happen to you? You know, or back in the 3 p.m. Didn't it just gets up my nose when that happens? Out of the office. There's a thing called the Office of the Believer. The word office means function, not just a building, a little room that you sit in. It's like the office of the priest. It means the function of the priest. You with me? Come on, please be a Te Rāwhiti church, be a Māori church, be a black church. Please, we've got to have communication here. I've got to make sure you're alive. So the office means the function of. And Aaron was in the office of a priest. The Levites in the office of a priest. Elijah was in the office of a prophet. Paul was in the office of an apostle. But there's another office, not besides apostles and prophets and evangelists. There's another office called the office of the believer, or the function of the believer. And, you know, we wait for, I wish only the apostles and prophets would rise in this nation and lead the church into revival. Well, I think, man, if only the office of the believer would get into their function, revival might come before that happens. So I want to tell you, or share with you, what is the office of the believer? And then you two to discern in your heart, where are you? Are you out of the office or are you in the office? Okay, so I'm bringing a whittle as well, a challenge, okay? I'm not here to, not just here to tickle the ears, and I'm here to do a whittle. And healing, well, a healing meeting, Healings take place in all my meetings. So I don't have a special healing meeting. It's healing because Jesus, the healer, is always here. And so so it's just, yeah, anyway. So the office of the believer, what is the scriptural basis of the office of a believer? Because everything's going to be based on the Word of God, right? You've got to have a foundation. If you build a house on the sand, pretty soon the old house is going to lean because bad foundation. You've got to build it on rock. Right. And so the foundation is the Word of God. Actually, the foundation of Christian faith is repentance. And the second foundation is faith towards God. The third foundation is baptism, in Hebrews 6 anyway. Repentance from dead works, faith towards God, doctrine of baptisms, laying on of hands, resurrection of the dead, and the eternal judgments. Paul says these are just the foundations of the Christian walk. And he says if God will let us move on into maturity, not laying again this foundation. So how many of us even laid the foundation? He said, God will let us go on to maturity after we've laid that foundation. So, yeah. What's resurrection of the dead mean? What's eternal judgment mean? It means we're going to judge angels. It means in the life after this, we're going to judge over God's, according to his word, God's people are going to rule over nations, territories, continents. Who rules over them today? Governments, presidents, kings, political leaders. But who rules over them in the spirit? Principalities and powers and demons and territorial spirits. But when Jesus comes, sets his kingdom up for 1,000 years on the earth, he's wiping out the devil. He's going to be put under the earth for 1,000 years. Nada, he's gone. Not only that, sin is gone. The Son of God is literally going to be ruling on the face of the planet. So who's going to be ruling over the planet, over the earth, over the nations where the principalities and the powers had influence over nations and towns? And so who's going to rule? Paul says, don't you know, you shall rule nations. You will judge angels. So that's, you know, that's eternal resurrection from the dead, and that's eternal judgment. So let's not go there today. Let's just go to the first foundation. Repentance from dead works. Then faith towards God. Look at this. When I came to Jesus, Arto, come to Jesus, your life will be better. Well, I'm smoking dope. I'm womanizing. I'm just a mongrel. I'm up to my neck in sin. I'm just doing my thing. And no one told me I had to repent. No one told me I had to turn away from that stuff. They said, just come to Jesus and life will be beautiful. And I wanted a beautiful life because I was a mess. I was depressed. I was all sorts of nonsense. Our marriage was broken. So we came to Jesus and true to the, he restored our hearts. But as I was walking with Jesus, believing in God, I was still having the odd, not the odd, I was actually having quite a bit of alcohol and drinks. And I was living that life as well as trying to follow Jesus. And I thought, what's happening here? It's like my house is sinking. This Jesus is great. Oh, and I'll get stoned or drunk one night or one weekend and go to church and feel guilty and go out and get saved again. And I kept getting saved again because I thought, oh, something's not right here. My pastor said, Norm, you only have to do it once. I says, well, I thought I was a new person and I felt new. When I opened my life to God, I felt new, but I don't feel new sometimes. I want to get stoned. And so what's up? This is what was up. No one taught me about repentance from dead works comes first. Not faith towards God, repentance. And I'd never been taught that this is the stuff, this is the old life you're meant to give up before you can embrace this new life. I was just told, come to Jesus, life will be beautiful. And we have thousands of Christians, tens of thousands of Christians in this nation struggling with sin in their lives. They love God, they're embracing Jesus, but they're struggling with stuff. Years later, they're still struggling because they never put down the foundation first and their house is sinking. The foundation is repent from dead works and they never understood. You mean let go of that life in order to embrace this one. So you got this wishy-washy, lukewarm Christianity TED Talks, psychological academic gospel that's trying to convince people to be Christians. But there's no power. There's a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. And so I discovered, oh, okay, when I found out I had to repent, I said, gee, I don't know if I'd have become a Christian then. Because I love my drug, sex, and rock and roll. And I don't know if I would have become a Christian if you said repent. I would have made it said, see, it's stuffed. But this is what repent means. Repent for me was, Norm, the way you're living is killing you. You know, you and you hate. It's not only killing you, it's killing the ones you love. I want you to just turn away from living like that, your selfish ways, and embrace my ways. That's what repent means. And when I saw it, oh, because you love me, you say, I love you, and you know, I want my best for you. It means you have to let go of these things. Why? Because it's killing you and it's killing the ones you love. It's broken your marriage up and it's destroying you. I don't want that anymore. He says, well, stop living like that and embrace my ways. And I'll show you how to be a better dad, better husband. So, oh, that's faith towards God. I wish I was told that at the start, because then I would have been able to be sort of psychologically prepared when I wanted to get stoned. No. And you see, I do this not out of guilt, and I don't do this out of shame, and I don't do it out of religious duty that I've got to, because otherwise God's going to slap me. He's not that sort of God. I do this out of whether I love him or not, and I had to make my mind up. Do I love you enough that I do this for you? Do you love him enough that you would do something like that for him? That's what Christianity is. It's about relationship with him. It's about a one-on-one. Kanohi ke te kanohi, face-to-face with Jesus. Do I love you enough? You've got to be honest with yourself, you know. Don't come to church, oh, I love you, Lord, I love you, Lord, I love you. He says, yeah, well, you better apologize to your wife. You're yelling and screaming it on the way to church. Oh, okay. You know, the devil is in the church car parks. And by your laugh, you know what I'm talking about. Hi, Pastor. Oh, praise the Lord. We're not perfect. And we're not even called to be perfect. Just called to follow him. As we follow the perfect one, he matures us. But you've got to be really honest with yourself. You've got to be honest. And I find with the counseling, there's a lot of people not afraid to be honest because I think God's going to whack them. Or they think they have to live up to a standard. They have to put on this mask, this performance, this expectation that pastor has of me. I've got no expectations of anyone. Let every man work out his own salvation with fear and trembling. I'm working out mine. I'm not here to judge you. We're not here to judge one another. We're here to affy one another, help one another, because we're all stumbling along this hikoi. It's called grace and mercy. So repent, let go of the things that are killing you and hurt and killing the ones you love the most. Oh, that's easy. But do I love you enough to do it? Or do I love myself more? And that's the other thing. How much do I love me? And how much do I love God? And so it's about centering your love on Jesus. That's what we and Jess have found, centering our love on Jesus. Our marriage is really tight. It didn't used to be. We had the honeymoon from hell. Honey, would you tell them about our honeymoon?
Do I have to? Our marriage was over before it began. And it was actually the wedding from hell as well. First of all, I was pregnant at the time and my mother didn't know, but my sister-in-law decided to tell her just before my wedding. And so it all went downhill from there for me because my mum wouldn't speak to me on my wedding day. And I mean, you know, fair enough, she was really hurt and disappointed in me. But it was my wedding day. And then Norm saw me talking to my girlfriend's boyfriend and he made it into something huge and started telling me that he didn't trust me and what was I doing with this guy and all the rest of it. And this was on my wedding day. And then we went off on our honeymoon and we were supposed to have two nights in a little place place about an hour away from Oamaru at the time. And he started drinking, and the next minute he was verbally abusing me and telling me that he didn't love me and he didn't want to be married. And that was my honeymoon. And so when we woke up in the morning, we went home to our house because there was no point staying there because it was over as far as I was concerned, the honeymoon anyway. I thought might as well just get on with what we're getting on with. So yeah, it was, and that's just the short story.
The honeymoon from hell, the wedding from hell, and the reason why, because I love myself more than God. I knew about God, but I wasn't following him. I knew he was real. I wasn't following him. And that's when, after 10 months of being married, we said, let's split. She had enough of me. I had enough of her. But I loved her. But I didn't know how to get, you know, work. I didn't know how to make it work. It's just, so anyway, we both decided, well, let's try God. If God's real, let's try God. If he doesn't work, we'll split. So we tried God on the 19th of December, 1995. We got down on our knees, put our hands together, because we thought that's how you pray. And it says, basically, 79, sorry, what did I say? 85, oh yeah. So, 1979. And we asked Jesus, help us. We're stuffed. Can you help us? Please. And we got up, didn't feel any change. But Jess said she felt hope. Hey, I didn't feel anything. I just felt, well, what I did was right. Then we went hunting for a church. The first Sunday, it was a dead church, so we went to another church. And we didn't even know it was a dead church, but we just knew there's no life here. And we found a church, and when the preacher spoke, he says, what's he doing talking about my life? How does he know about me? And every message was, what is he talking about me? Anyway, the reason why my life was a mess, and the marriage was a mess, because I loved myself more. It was me. Number one. And that was the first thing I had to repent of, self-love. People say, well, you've got to love yourself before you can love others. So that's psychological crap. It's crap. It's nonsense. It's not truth. It's crap. God says, love me first with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Secondly, love your neighbor. Don't love yourself and then love me. You love me first because I will heal your heart. And my love will flow through, give you the capacity to love those that you find hard to love. And that's how it works. And so I had to learn how to repent and turn away from things that are not just killing me, but killing my marriage, killing the ones I love the most. And it boiled down to how much do I love you, though? And so there are times I didn't want to, but then I'd be reminded, but you said you loved me. I said, oh. And that's a good thing. You said you loved me. And you prove your love. Prove your love to me. And so that's why we walked for 43 years, 42 years, we walked like that. Just loving Jesus. Okay? We're not experts. We're not perfect. So what is the office of the believer? Let's go back to the office of the believer. Because if you're a believer, I'm talking to you and about you. Jesus is talking about you. Okay, let's turn to John chapter 14, verse 12. And these are the words of Jesus himself, the Son of God. And he's speaking to the apostles. So listen, I think many Christians believe that Jesus is speaking about a certain class of Christian, about an apostle, a prophet. Okay? So I want you to help me clarify who is Jesus speaking about here. Okay, he says the word, truly, truly, I say unto you. Who's the you he's talking to? In the context of that time in history. Who was he talking to back then? Yeah, he was, but at the start, who is he talking to? He's talking to the apostles. Okay, he's talking to the apostles. He's saying, truly, truly, I say unto you, you 12 apostles, he that believes in me, now who's he that believes in me? Who's he that believes in me? It's us. It's not a trick question. He that believes in me. Do you believe in Jesus? You know, isn't in the context of salvation that he died for your sin and that he's your savior. And do you believe in him? We do, eh? Okay? So he's speaking about you and me. He's speaking about us. He's speaking out not just believers in his day, because Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. So what he said yesterday is what he says today and what will always be. So he's saying, whoever believes in me, the works I do, okay, what works did Jesus do? Fed 1,000 with a pizza, raised the dead, cast out demons, healed the sick, brought hope to the hopeless, fed the hungry. What are the works of Jesus? So listen, so please, Holy Spirit, help us not fob this off to somebody else. Help us not to fob this off to somebody. Holy Spirit, convict us of what you are saying to us right now. Nowhere to hide. Not out of guilt, no. Not out of shame, but just out of revelation. Thank you. He's saying, if you and I believe in him, the things that Jesus did, he said, you will do also. And not only that, greater works. I mean, I'm just struggling to do the things he did, let alone the greater works. I haven't walked on water. But my shadow has healed the sick. People have touched my garment and been instantly healed. I've spat in people's eyes and they've been opened again. I've done some of the works of Jesus. And people say, who do you think you are doing that? So I write back at you, and who do you think you are that you're not? Who do you think you are? Because as a man thinks in his heart, that's who he is. So who do you think you are? Well, God didn't call us to do that. Well, that's the problem. You don't know him, and you don't know his word. I think I am who Jesus said I am. That the works he did, he said, I will do. That's who I think I am. I'm in my office as a believer. This is the function of a believer. This is the office of the believer. And I'm not out of my office like you. And people need help from Jesus, supernatural intervention, and they knock on the door of many churches. Where's the supernatural presence? He's out of the office, because the believers are not in the office. They're not in the office of the believer. They don't believe they have the capacity by the Holy Ghost to lay hands on the sick and see them recover. They don't believe the miracle-working Son of God that raised the dead literally lives in them, that he can bring dead back here in Aotearoa, Ruakaka. They don't believe. So that's the first scripture, the foundation of the office of the believer. The second scripture is Mark chapter 16, verse 17. Would you turn to that, please? If you've got an issue with this message, take it up with the Word of God. No. Mark chapter 16, verse 17. Again, who is Jesus speaking to? He's speaking to the apostles. Who's he talking about? Well, let's read it. He says, and these signs shall follow them that believe. Who? Would you say with me? Them that believe. Please say, he's speaking about me. One more time. One more time. Holy Spirit, do your thing. He's speaking about you and me. Okay? What are the signs? They will. What's it say in your Bible? What's the first sign? They will cast out devils. When was the last time you cast an evil spirit out of a human being and their lives radically changed? When was the last time you cast out a devil, a spirit, out of a human being and their lives radically changed? Well, that's not my job. That's the pastor's job. He's paid for that. That's the mentality. And some pastors, well, that's not me, that's my gift, that's the apostle's job. That's the prophet's job. It's the evangelist, that's what they do. Mark, Jesus says, these signs shall follow them that believe, that they'll believe. Believe it. That's right, darling. It's you. And so somebody comes to the house, dying of stage 4 cancer, and they walk in, sitting there dribbling away, and no one prays for them, and they go home and they die. Because there's a sign of the door, out of the office, in the spirit, out of the office, out of the office. So Jesus, it's like this is metaphoric, this isn't literal. It's like Jesus rings up from heaven. Holy Spirit, yep. You're in Ruakaka, yep. Okay, number something something, Bream Bay Road. There's a fella in there. He's suicidal. He's got a shotgun. He's going to blow his head off. But he's crying out to me. He sent some texts up to me. He says, if there's a God up there, show me, and I'll turn my life around. So Holy Spirit, send one of my believers along. And Holy Spirit says, Roger, Jesus. And 5 minutes later, Jesus rings, Holy Spirit, yes. What's happening down there? Nothing's happening. The guy's still screaming. Holy Spirit, sorry, Jesus. The believers are out of their office. So where are they? They're in church praying for that neighborhood. What? They're in church praying for the neighborhood. Oh. I'm not exaggerating. It challenges me. I had a dream a few months ago. And in the dream, I was going from door to door, knocking on houses. And people would answer, yes. And I had a seed in my hand. I says, here, I want to give you this. And the seed was a seed of hope. And I gave it to them. Their little faces went, and they smiled. And so I went to the next door. And I did this from door to door. And I was walking door to door. The Spirit of God said to me, I want you to go door to door in your city. And I want you to sow seeds of hope into the hearts of the people. And I woke up. And it was so real. I says, really? You want me to literally? Door, knock on doors? I said, what's the seed? He says, the seed is not a seed. The seed is hope. And he said, I want you to offer hope in the form of this. Knock on the door and say, I'm from the House of Breakthrough Neighborhood Support System, a neighborhood support. And we've got a list of needs that we can help you with. Budgeting advice, addiction counseling, food parcels. Just a list of things that we can help you with. And I said, we're from the House of Breakthrough Neighborhood Support, and here's a list of needs. If you've got any of these needs, we're here to help you. Clean your backyard up. Do your lawns. We've done a few lawns. We've carted away a few dozen beer bottles, I tell you that. We've been to party houses, man, and cleaned up their rubbish. And I mean, but their hearts are touched. And some of these, they ask, and we also karakia, prayer. We're praying for them on the streets and they're breaking down and weeping. We've got them coming to church. See, that's the office of the believer. It's not within the house. It's taking the Jesus of the house into the community. That's called kingdom. That's the kingdom embraces humanity. Churches, unfortunately, usually embrace Christians. And there's nothing wrong with churches looking after each other. We're meant to be a training ground, and we uffy one another, we support one another, we're family, we look after one another, and that's all good. But we're meant to train one another how to get out there in the office of a believer and touch our community, touch our neighbors, touch our family. Instead of praying and moaning about the gang problem, let's be the solution. Office of the believer. So are you in or out of your office? When was the last time you cast out a devil? So that's one of the signs. They will cast out devils or speak in other tongues. Oh, we can speak in tongues, okay. They will take up serpents. If you drink anything deadly, they will not harm them. They will lay hands on the sick and they will recover. When was the last time you laid hands on a sick person and they got better? No, don't put your hand up. I'm not trying to shame or guilt you. You can't be motivated by shame or by guilt, but you must be convicted and motivated by love. Number one, love for Jesus and love for people. And the big problem is love for ourselves. And love for ourselves. That's my problem. I love myself too much sometimes. And I want my way. Not my will be done, but thine, O Lord. It's a lovely song, but it's a lot harder to do, isn't it? Because we're selfish beings. We're created. We were born in sin. We were born selfish. It's part of the nature that comes from Adam. And Jesus is the last Adam. We've got the nature of God in us, the divine nature of God. But we've got to learn how to yield to that. And it's no good saying, oh, I'm a new creation, and we still live according to the old nature. We've got to keep yielding to the new nature of God. And so the nature of God loves people. And it sees a need, it wants to be the solution, because Jesus is this. Well, Jesus didn't send an answer. God didn't send an answer, he sent a person. God doesn't send solutions, he sends people. God doesn't send solutions, he sends people. He doesn't send programs, he sends people. Now, programs are okay in the context that they use, but he sends people. He sends people. And your neighborhoods are ripe for revival. There are people sitting there in your houses and your neighbors who would be in church if you invited them. They would. So, last time I cast out a demon, yesterday. Last time I lay hands on somebody that got healed was yesterday. And before that, the day before. Fella, and I was at Onehunga on Monday, and this fella was there, and he said, you said there's someone in the room, their back's being healed right now. And he says, you said that my back had been in pain. He says, it just began to straighten up like that. And it's been completely free since. That was on Monday, and I was talking to him yesterday. I didn't even touch him. It's just Jesus in me. That's the office of the believer. The works I do, you will do also. So Jesus would just speak to people, and they get healed. He said, pick up your bed and walk. Imagine having words like that. You do have words like that. I want to encourage you. What I do is not me. It's Jesus. I'm not the healer. I'm not a healer. I can't heal a fly. I'm a hose. I'm a hose. A hose has water that flows through it. When it touches the seed, it brings life into the seed. It brings life into the fennel, into the dirt. The water flowing through the hose. But the water must have a hose to flow through. And a hose must have water. So you need one another, but the life is the water in the hose. The life is the Spirit of Christ in me. I'm just a hose. You are just a hose. Tell the person next to you, you're a lovely looking hose. So there's blonde hoses, there's brunette hoses, there's blackhead hoses, there's young hoses, there's older hoses. We're all hoses. A hostess. I like that. You're a hose with the hostess with the mostess. So we're hoses. But the hoses are only useful when there's something flowing, when there's water flowing through it. And I cannot heal. And I thank God he does. And I step in my office and say, well, God, you said I would do the things you said I could do. So I'm going to step out and do them. I can't make it happen, but I'm just going to obey you and see what happens. Started doing this about over 40 years ago. Haven't stopped. I'm still amazed. Anytime God heals somebody, anytime God does a miracle, I'm just, what? But I've got to forget about it because you can get a big head about all this, you see. You're going to think, oh, look at me. Look at my ministry. So I got to forget about it and put it away for the glory of God, that it's his glory, not mine. And just forget about it. Just forget you ever did it. But I do pull them out every now and again as examples. That's only but I give glory to God because it's for him. It's for his glory, not for me. And it's for the well-being of the people. And you just keep on working every day as if you've never done anything for God. You just keep on working every day as if you've done nothing for God. So Jess says, I don't want to just love God. I want to please God. I don't want to just be loved by God. I want to be pleasing to God. See, God, Jesus, what did God say of his son? This is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased. So he loves us all, but it's no big deal. Just because God loves me or you, it's no big deal. He even loved Hitler. He loves sinners. So I'm loved. I know God loves me. I know God loves me. I know I shouldn't be walking like this, but I know that God loves me. Don't judge me. God loves me. It's a big deal. God loves sinners. But is God pleased with you? Why don't you live a life that's pleasing to God? That brings purpose. That brings challenge. That's what we're meant to do. Live a life that brings pleasure to God. How do you do that? Get in your flipping office. Just be a believer. Just step number one. Forget about the office of the prophet and the apostle. If the body of Christ would get back into its office as believers, you'd see the move of God all across this nation. You would. That's how our church in India is growing. hundreds to thousands, because they just believe what the Word of God says they are, and they go out and do it. They don't have health systems like we have here. They don't have social security and network systems, support systems. They just die until they hear that there's a God that loves them and is a supernatural God that can raise the dead. And there's just hundreds of testimonies of the church over there of what God has done through them, which has drawn Muslim families, which has drawn Hindu families, which has drawn communist families. Families who hated Christians. Families that hated this Jesus Christ. Called him the white man's God. All sorts of stuff. Colonialist. But Jesus is who he is. So the office of the believer. Are you in your office or are you out of your office? Ask the person, are you out of your office? Ask the person next to you. Are you out of your office? Are you out of your office? When you're in your office, you've got purpose. When you're in your office, you got to live always ready. It's not an event lifestyle. It's a lifestyle lifestyle. It's not an event, oh, well, who am I going to pray for today? It's just live your life as normal. God will bring across your path people that need prayer. God will bring across your path people that need something. But at the same, keep your eyes open. I'm always looking. Looking for someone the Holy Spirit's wanted to touch. On the plane, on the train, at Pack and Save. One day there was a fella in Pack and Save, and I knew the man. I knew he had heart issues. And he's leaning on his trolley, and he's having a heart attack in Pack and Save. So I went up to him, bro, you okay? And he's going, heart. So most people probably call an ambulance. I don't know, I'll call Jesus. So, now there's a place for doctors. This, you know, don't be stupid if you don't have the faith for that. But, you know, but I said, on the count of three, you move forward. You just lean forward into the presence of Jesus. He went, I said, tahi rua toru. And he went, and he moved forward and leant on his trolley, just, literally, just like that, within seconds. Kia ora, bro, thank you. Yes, he did that, and he pushed his trolley and he continued to shop. This is a true story. This is lifestyle. This is how I roll. This is how I live. This is lifestyle. This is not an event. This is just in Pack and Save. Because I'm in my office, you see? And if I wasn't in my office, he would have missed out. And there's so many people missing out in our nation because we are not in our office. And it's not to shame us, but it's because we're selfish. And one of the things we need to repent of is our selfishness, that we love ourselves more than Jesus. We love ourselves more than his will for people. And so if you need to do that, just ask God to forgive you. Repent of being so inwardly looking. Say, Lord, help me look and see the way you see. Help me see people the way you see them. And to love you more than I love myself. That's a biblical prayer. That's what God's trying to do for us. Why? When you love God more than yourself, you get free of yourself. Selfish, I hate that selfish nature. It's so ugly. But to be like Jesus, oh man, that's freedom. That's freedom. And what's he trying to do? He's trying to kill us. He's just trying to kill us. In a good sense. Galatians 2:20, I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live in it, not I, but Christ that lives in me. It's about dying to self and letting Christ flow through us. Anyway, healings. So Jess was coming up and she had a word about somebody with bones or broken bones. So is anybody here and you got a bone issue, bone problem? Anybody? Just indicate. I have a problem with the atmosphere of most Kiwi churches because it's so full of, and not the fault of the Christians, it's what's been taught to them. And they're taught they're going to have all this faith and you're going to be holy and you're going to do this and this and that. Or you've got a war for you. And it's such nonsense. It's such utter nonsense. And it puts all these expectations, and it blocks off the free flow of the Holy Spirit, because the soul gets involved, the mind gets involved, human rationale gets involved, and it cuts off the childlike faith of just, oh, Jesus. Okay? And so half the time of my meetings, I'm unwinding Christians from all these mindsets, these blocks, these religious roadblocks that they've been taught over the decades in our nation. It's just nonsense. I don't have this problem when I go to the third world. When I speak, usually indigenous cultures, they get it straight away because they think from their spirit, from their heart, more than from their rationale. That doesn't mean they don't have a rationale. They do, but they respond to God, or they respond to the spirit. Hindus respond to the spirit because they believe in all the demons. They believe in spirits. They believe if a holy man will touch them, they will be blessed. So they see us as holy men, holy women, because Jesus is in us, and they believe if we touch them, they will get healed. And that's how the miracles happen. Bang, 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 bang. Blind people getting healed, cripples walking. Hindus, not Christians, who haven't got chapter and verse, please. Where is that in the Bible? I was taught this. I know my Bible. Well, these guys don't know no Bible. They only have great need, and Holy Spirit knows them, and Jesus loves them. And Holy Spirit just goes right past all our gobbledygook and goes in and heals their little bodies. And they go, oh, that's good. Oh. And then their hearts change, and they become Christians. And then we have the mullahs chasing us. That's all right. It's all right. So I want to tell you, how do you get faith? Honor. Honor Jesus. Honor his word. Honor. 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 Honor is easier to do than have faith. Yeah? It's easier to honor a person than to have faith in a person. Jesus was in Nazareth, his hometown, and they said, we know who you are. You're the carpenter's son. We know your brothers, your sisters. Who do you think you are telling us these things? Such dishonor. And Jesus said, a prophet is without honor where? In his own house, his own town. So dishonor. And then Jesus, he marveled at their what? Unbelief. You listening? Dishonor and unbelief are synonymous. You with me? Track with me. Watch this. You'll see something. Up the road at Capernaum, there's a centurion. He's not a Jew. He's a Gentile. And he's got such honor for Jesus that he's never met before. He says, I'm not even worthy to be under the same roof as that man. So he sent the Jewish elders to go down there and ask this Jesus if he will just say the word and my servant will be healed. That's huge honor. Huge honor. And Jesus comes to this guy and says, I haven't found faith like you in all of Israel. So honor and faith. Dishonor and belief. See the connection? People want great faith. I says, learn to have great honor. People want great faith in God. I said, learn to have great honor to God. And when you begin to honor God with, because you can't put faith in someone you don't honor. But when you honor somebody, you put faith in them. And I want to encourage you, put great honor to Jesus, into the presence of Jesus. Put honor to the Holy Spirit. Honor his presence. Honor him. Honor the words of Jesus. He sent his word and healed them. Do we honor his word? His word says, by my stripes you are healed. I don't need to lay hands on you. You're already healed. All you have to do is receive it. But do we honor that word? Nah. Oh no, the man of God's got to touch me. He's got to anoint me with oil. He's got to spit on me. He's got to do something. He's got to shake me. How about like the centurion said, just say the word. Just say the word. Such honor to the word. If we would have such honor just to his presence, and we're worshiping God, just honoring his presence and giving all to him. When we're worshiping, the healing started taking place. Because our focus is on him. It's giving honor. It's giving honor. That's why I use worship and miracle meetings. And once I feel he's honored, and Holy Spirit says, I'm this is a safe house, Norm. You can minister me here. Because if it's not safe, he said, no, don't minister me here. There's no honor, no hunger, and no humility. So I can't minister Holy Spirit in places. He wants to be released in here. And I've got to untie you from your religious mindsets that someone's put on you. I want to set you free in the name of Jesus Christ. You do not have to have great faith. You do not have to be perfect, holy. In fact, you don't even have to be a believer. I've seen thousands and thousands of unbelievers get healed. Cancers off Muslims and Hindus. One unbeliever, he was saying as the power of God was going through him and straightening his leg out. If in hell, what's happening to me? We look at one another. Holy Spirit doesn't seem to mind. He's just moving through this guy and he's healing this guy's back. He's a gang member. I'm working with gang members sometimes, and one gang member I was working with a few months ago, he's one of the most violent people in Gisborne. He's been fed for years. It's crazy. When he snaps, he wants to kill people. He's only at a hospital, prison for longer than 2 weeks. He's been in prison for 30 years, in and out, in and out, in and out. But he said to me, I want out. I don't want to live this life anymore. I want help. I said, I'll help you, bro. So I'm teaching him about Jesus, but I've got to get down to his level. I said, Jesus has got to be your prayers. You know, the president of the club, Jesus must be your prayers. I said, okay. So whatever the prayer says, you've got to do. Dapai? Because you're loyal to your prayers. And your prayers wants the best for you. Yep. And so he's got an ankle bracelet on. If he goes off the property, he gets locked up in jail again. He stayed out with me for 10 months. The longest was 2 weeks. He stayed out for 10 months. He's back in jail now because he was only out on remand, and so he's back in jail for a couple of years for trying to kill someone. He's a neat guy. On his right side. Nah. So I said to him, you gotta cry out to Jesus. Help me, Jesus. I said, do that? Yeah, okay. So he's got two women, one for sex and one for just doing other jobs. That's the way they live. But Jesus loves him. Jesus loves him. And Jesus loves his efforts to try and